لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم آمين. We are still continuing to tackle the issue about good manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the subject today is about whom should we take for a judge if we truly respect Allah. And the reason that this is quite very relevant to good manners with Allah is when you have trouble with anyone and you need someone to help you get out of a quandary or a problem or dispute, you look for someone you respect. You look for someone you trust. You trust both their knowledge, their wisdom, and their fairness. That's what you look for in a judge, right? So when we have Allah, when we have the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as our ultimate sources of judgment, and then we go and choose someone else, what does this say? Bad manners. It means we do not trust Allah enough. And that was one of the characteristics of the hypocrites. The hypocrites, the Quran says, وَإِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ. If they are invited to Allah and or His Messenger to judge between them, they turn away. تَرَى الْمُنَافِقِينَ يَصُدُّونَ عَنْكَ صُدُودًا. You find them turning away because what? The Quran asks rhetorical questions. Are they afraid that Allah or His Messenger would not be fair to them? أَمْ يَخَافُونَ أَنْ يَحِيفَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ وَرَسُولُهُ. Why do people, especially those who claim to be Muslims, want to use French law, British law, US law, and all laws except the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why? Could it be ignorance, sheer ignorance? But those people are surrounded with scholars, and they have access to the best scholars in their community. They could ask. So ignorance could not be an excuse. What could be a reason for a nation that has the book of Allah to judge by any other source, except that they either are not absolutely sure that Allah has the better judgment and the best judgment, or they are not sure that what they want will be achieved through the book of Allah. The book of Allah requires justice between the ruled and the ruler, requires justice in distribution of resources, requires fairness when you judge between people, requires no favoritism, that you are the same with everybody else. So if I want to lead a community without abiding by all of the above, what do? I seek other judgments, because I know if I say I follow the Quran and I do not, people will hold my feet to the fire. But if I say I'm following the law, I can change the law as I wish. And this is part and parcel of the central struggle between our Muslim peoples everywhere and the rulers wherever they are. This is the crux of the serious problem between the community and the leaders. That the leaders want to judge by whim and desire, and the community wants to be ruled by Allah's rules. Allah doesn't favor anybody. Allah does not have biases. Allah does not have any interest towards or against any person. So here is what the Quran says about the Quran. After talking about the Torah and the Injil for the people of the book, Allah talks directly now to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and He tells him, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ بِالْحَقِّ. We have sent down the book in truth, so that you may judge among people by that which Allah has sent down to you. لتحكم بين الناس, so that you judge among people. فاحكم بينهم, judge between them بما أنزل الله ولا تتبع أهواءهم. Judge between them and judge among them by that which Allah has sent down to you. And follow not their whims and desires. Follow not their whims and desires. They want it right, they want it left. It doesn't matter. Do what Allah tells you to do. Judge by the book. So if this is what Allah says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and while he is saying judge by the book, he is warning against وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ عَمَّا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. Don't turn away based on their whims and desires from the truth that we have sent down to you. We've given you truth, you judge by truth. لِكُلٍ جَعَلْنَا مِنْكُمْ شِرْعَةً وَمِنْهَاجًا وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَجَعَلَكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَلَكِنْ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ فِي مَا آتَاكُمْ فاستبقوا الخيرات إلى الله مرجعكم جميعا فينبئكم بما كنتم فيه تختلفون. Every community, the Jews have their laws, Christians have their book, and Allah sent the Prophet, the Quran, to judge between even the Jews and the Christians. If they come, to judge by what Allah sent down to him, not by their whims and desires. Every community has a law. That's what the Quran is saying. And then he moves on to say, وَأَنِحْكُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهِ وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ وَاحْذَرْهُمْ أَنْ يَفْتِنُوكَ عَنْ بَعْضِ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Be careful. Judge among them by the book. And be careful not to be dragged by their wants and desires to use any other reference. So if this is the way Allah's talking to the Prophet, how does Allah talk to us as basic lay human people who are following Islam or supposed to follow Islam? Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. When you judge among people, you judge according to the rules of justice. Where do we find the rules of justice? In the Quran, in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So seeking any judgment based on any other source is what? Well, to understand this, we have to go back to what Allah said to the people who received the Torah, to the people who received the Injil, and what rule, what judgment Allah has about people who do not use Allah's judgment. So if you go back a couple of ayahs in the same surah, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, you will find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَا التَّوْرَاةَ فِيهَا هُدًى وَنُورٍ. We have sent down the Torah in which there is light and guidance. يَحْكُمُ بِهَا النَّبِيُّونَ الَّذِينَ أَسْلَمُوا. To be used as a source of judgment by those prophets who have submitted to Allah. وَالَّذِينَ هَادُوا لِلَّذِينَ هَادُوا. To use it for judgment among those who said that they are Jewish or that they have been returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the word Yahud and Hadu comes from the root word Hada. Hada is to go back. And in the Jewish community, in the followers of Prophet Musa, you can tell that they returned on two accounts. Allah would forgive them, they would return back to disobedience. They would return back to disobedience, then Allah will tell them, you have to make tawbah. So they return and make tawbah. Then they go back to disobedience. And the cycle kept going on until Moses died of desperation of his own community. So they had, they kept coming back to disobedience, coming back to repentance, until Musa literally prayed against them. He said, Rabbi, لو شئت أهلكتهم من قبل وإياي. If you will, Allah, you would have demolished them. I know they deserve it. That's what he's saying. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of mercy, he kept giving them chances after chances after chances, and they keep going back. This is the word هادا بمعنى راجع. And Yahud means he goes back. Do they also not go back on their commitment and their promises? Do they renege on their promises? They do. And this is what they did with Musa and with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever they make a commitment and Allah gives them relief and forgive their sins, they come back again with disobedience and sinfulness. So the word hada comes from returning back to whatever they were doing, whether it is obedience or tawbah or disobedience and reneging on their commitment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So يحكم بها النبيون الذين أسلموا للذين هادوا والربانيون والأحبار. And the rabbis and scholars and anchorites and priests, بما استحفظوا من كتاب الله, according to what they have been entrusted to keep of the book of Allah. This is what they use for judgment. That's what the Quran expects of them. And then Allah says, فَلَا تَخْشَوُ النَّاسِ, fear not anybody, وَخْشَوْنِي, and fear me, وَلَا تَشْتَرُوا بِآيَاتِي ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا, don't you sell out my ayat for a small price. Don't sell out my ayat, my revelation, my guidance, my science, my evidence, my proofs. Don't give them away for a small price. And any price you collect for selling the ayat of Allah is a small price. Even if you get the whole world, it's a small price. And then he says, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. He who does not judge according to the book of Allah, he is a kafir. And they are kafirun. Those who do not judge by the book of Allah, the ayah says they are kafirun. Kafirun means what here? It means they have denied Allah the right to judge. They have denied his wisdom. They have denied his knowledge. They have denied his justice, his fairness. They have denied the fact that Allah would never favor one against another, that Allah has no interest in whatever judgment he renders and offers to people to use. Then Allah says, وَكَتَبْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ فِيهَا أَنَّ النَّفْسَ بِالنَّفْسِ. We have prescribed unto them in it, in the Torah, that a soul is for the soul, which means retribution. وَالْعَيْنَ بِالْعَيْنِ, an eye for an eye. وَالْأَنْفَ بِالْأَنْفِ, and a nose for a nose. وَالْأُذُنَ بِالْأُذُنِ, an ear for an ear. وَالسِّنَّ بِالسِّنِ, and a tooth for a tooth. وَالْجُرُوحَ قِصَاصٍ, and wounds are all subject to retribution. Which means, if you break somebody's nose, he has the right to break your nose. If you cause somebody deafness by slamming his ear, you are liable to be also turned deaf by him slamming you or forgiving you for that. So, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ, هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Those are the wrongdoers, those who do not use Allah's references as a source of judgment. They are unjust, unfair, and they are the wrongdoers. Who wants to be a wrongdoer? That you know what Allah judges for you or against you, and you want to go against it. What kind of respect is this? What kind of good manners is this? When we know what Allah says. And then Allah says, وَقَفَّيْنَا عَلَىٰ آثَرِهِمْ بِعِيسَى بْنِ مَرْيَمْ. We have followed this generation with Isa ibn Maryam. And we have given him the Injil, مصدقا لما بين يديه من التوراة confirming what he has received beforehand, what they have received of the Torah, and we gave him the Injil. We have given him the Injil, the message that Allah gave to Isa, in which the substance and the core is Islam, submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? So, آتيناه الإنجيل فيه هدى ونور وموعظة للمتقين. It has guidance and admonishment for those who have taqwa. We spoke about taqwa, need not to explain it again. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant for us to take those communities and learn from their lessons, learn from their experience, and learn what Allah says about them. And then the Quran says the same ayah, the following ayah, وَلْيَحْكُمْ أَهْلُ الْإِنْجِيلِ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ. So let the people of the gospel judge by the gospel, the book that was given to Isa. Let them judge by the gospel, the book that was given to Isa alayhi salam, not the books they have written with their own hands. The Injil is the book that was given to Isa. Let them judge by the Injil as it was given to Isa alayhi salam. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. He who does not judge by the book that was revealed and sent down by Allah, they are the disobedient ones. Why is this whole text talking about who does not judge, who he does not judge by the book is a kafir, a zalim, a fasiq? And then following this comes discussion and talk to the Prophet and by extension to his community to use the Quran as the judge. And the Quran is mentioned in this context, بِالْحَقِّ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَمُهَيْمِنًا عَلَيْهِ. The Quran supersedes whatever revelation that was given before. Supersedes means what? مُهَيْمِنًا. It is the criterion by which you judge what in these references is right and what in them is not. So you have the final revelation. As Sheikh Ahmed did that, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless his soul, used to say, excuse me, if there is such a thing as the Old Testament, and if there is such a thing, and there is, and if there is such a thing as the New Testament, there must be such a thing as the Last Testament. And the Last Testament is the Quran, except for one thing. It's not written and dictated by people. It is not people's memories and people's ideas, corrections or reviews or anything. It is Allah's word. The only book that was kept in its original language from cover to cover by the immediate companions of the Prophet is the Quran. Jesus, alayhi salam, never saw the gospel as we see it today. He never saw it. Moses never knew that somebody after him will be writing the Torah after he has died by centuries. The time distance is too far to rely on somebody's memory after generations have come and gone. So we have to be careful that if the people of the book find it fit to bring laws different from their books, it is because their books were limited in time and were limited in authenticity and credibility and the scope. But the Quran, we cannot apply the same to the Quran. The Quran never gets old. Like some people today say, a 1400-year-old book, how come you want to use it for contemporary issues? Well, give me an issue that the Quran doesn't address, then you can prove your point. But there is not a single issue that matters to any single human being in this universe where the Quran doesn't give you an answer. Nothing. فيه خبر ما قبلكم وحكم ما بينكم ونبأ ما بعدكم. What else do you need? It has the news about what happened and the judgment amongst you for what is happening and the news about what is going to happen. What else do you need? So it's not only a law book, it is a reference for life from the beginning of the creation of Adam until the day of judgment. What book covers all of that, both with consistency, with credibility, with authenticity, in a language that has never changed? If you look at keeping the Quran itself, part of it comes as keeping and protecting the Arabic language itself and spreading the language, even in communities that do not normally speak Arabic, who have their own languages, the Quran is still a book of reference and a book of knowledge. Even for communities whose mother tongue is not Arabic, their youngest kids can and do memorize the Quran in its original language. What more miracles does Allah need to show us so that our arrogance turns into humility? So that looking outside for references will turn us into our own book. What does Allah need to do more than this? Then the Quran talks about us. So we read the ayat talking with the people of the book, the Jews and Christians, and generally with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now the Quran talks to us, and it says, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It's not befitting for a believer, man or woman, that when Allah gives a judgment, that they still think they have a choice other than what Allah has given of judgment. Allah's stripping you of choices where He has His say. What else does He need to tell you? What else? Do you know what? Much less than this happens and we submit to it. If a policeman stops you and he takes your license, your insurance paper, and you start explaining things to him, and he says, sir, don't talk, I'm checking. Do you talk? Do you still continue to talk? When he gives you a ticket and he says, it's finished, do you still keep talking? Why do we have that much respect for people in authority, and we do not have enough respect for Allah? Why? Why is it? You think about it and you will find that it's because we recognize the authority of the person in authority. We are ready to recognize it immediately, but because we forget Allah, because we do not remember Allah except few times, لا يذكرون الله إلا قليلا. So we tend to overlook both His power, His knowledge, His expertise, and His wisdom, and by extension, His authority. So when we get into disputes, a wife comes, for example, and says, I'm going to the court. Why, sister, do you want to go to the court? The court will give me more than what you will give me. What is this? What is this? Or a brother who comes and says, I am going to the court. Why? Because I have documents that will support my case. What do you want your support, the support of your case to prove? Oh, I am not going to show them all my income, so I'm going to pay less. She thinks she's getting more by going to the court? No, no, no. I know how to play the game. So life has not become the serious journey that we are using to get closer to Allah. It is rather a game of who wins more money, who turns the other sad, who defeats the other, and who wins against the other, instead of where truth is, where justice is. This is serious. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. Now the Quran is raising the issue way beyond even good manners. The Quran is saying, nay, by Allah, they would not be believers until and unless they take your judgment in matters in which they dispute. And then they find no reluctance in their heart. ثم لا يجدوا في أنفسهم حرجا مما قضيت. Their chest is not tight because of your judgment. And then what? ويسلموا تسليما. And they come in full unconditional submission. إنما كان أمر المؤمنين إذا دعوا إلى الله ورسوله ليحكم بينهم أن يقولوا سمعنا وأطعنا. The attitude and the position of the believer when invited to for the judgment of Allah and His Messenger, the only position he or she has is to say سمعنا وأطعنا. We hear and we obey. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among the people who hear and obey. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا مولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله وبعد. It is easy to understand where our position should be as Muslims, people who submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is actually difficult to many of us, unfortunately, is to want to do it. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would reward you or punish you for any work you do based on your intention. You may do something good, but the intention is not pure for Allah, you may not get any reward. Actually, you may be punished. If you pray, prayer is good, but the purpose of your prayer is to show people that you are praying. You're going to get married, so you want to show the family that you are a good man. So the Asr time comes, you say, give me the prayer rug, I want to make wudu, you pray. But actually you don't pray in other times. That prayer counts against you, not for you. So the intention matters, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlighted in the Quran consistently that you are judged by what you want. من كان يريد العاجلة عجلنا له فيها ما نشاء لمن نريد ثم جعلنا له جهنم يصلاها مذموما مدحورا ومن أراد الآخرة. And he who is focused on the hereafter, that is what he wants or she wants, then this is their سعي will be سعيا مشكورا فأولئك كان سعيهم مشكورا. But they have to do it on basis of their faith. وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ. So we have to be careful that even when we do something, that we anchor what we do in our faith, not in benefit and personal interest. Your benefit is to follow. Your benefit is not to get something. And your harm is not to lose something. Your harm is when you do not follow Allah and His Messenger. This is the bottom line of realigning our heads and our hearts to fit what Allah expects of us. Then and only then we can start to claim that we have good manners with Allah. That when Allah speaks, all else are silent. When Allah judges, the discussion is over. When the Prophet ﷺ guides, there is no need to seek guidance from anywhere else. That's what it means to be a Muslim, to submit to Allah and to accept the judgment of Allah and or the judgment of the Prophet. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهِ. Obey Allah. وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولِ. And obey the Messenger. Then أولي الأمر, people in authority among you, from amongst you, are to be obeyed only if they comply with the judgment of Allah and the judgment of His Prophet. Unfortunately, we have people today, as we speak, who are justifying for tyrants to do anything they want because they are in authority. Because they are in authority, no matter how wrong they could be, no matter what they use for references, no matter how sincere they are in what they are doing in terms of serving the community. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the obedience to Allah unconditional. The obedience to His Messenger unconditional. But the obedience to people in authority is conditioned upon their obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is manifested in the statement of the Khulafa. They all said, أَطِيعُونِي مَا أَطَعْتُ اللَّهَ فِيكُمْ. Listen and obey so long as I obey Allah and His Messenger. This is the rule. So how is it that some people, and some of them are educated, and unfortunately some of them are called scholars of Islam, they justify oppression and repression and injustice and discrimination just because it comes from the ruler, and they claim that so long as they let you pray, right, then you have to listen to them. مَا أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ فِيكُمْ. So long as they pray and they let you pray, they can do anything. Where in the book of Allah do you find this? Where does it say obey anybody, even your parents? Your parents who have the third obedience commitment from you as a Muslim, Allah says, وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا. If they strive to push you to make shirk, to associate anything or anyone with Allah, do not obey them. Very clear. Why should we obey people in authority who are pushing the ummah, all the ummah, in the trenches of the enemies of Islam, who are disregarding our interest, who are entrenching their tyranny and control, not only over our resources, but over ourselves, whipping our backs and insulting our elders and imprisoning our scholars? How could we think that those people have still authority, when the authority actually is referred to you? You should give them that authority. But even if you tell them do whatever you can, that authority is illegitimate. They cannot do whatever they want. They are only legitimate if they follow the Quran. That is their legitimacy. The second rule for legitimacy is when they are accepted by the community. Not coming by force, not coming by the guns to our heads. Either we rule you or we kill you. That is not acceptable. But we the people make it acceptable by accepting their authority, even though we know that it is illegitimate. And that's why enjoining the good and forbidding the evil, some scholars count it as the sixth pillar of Islam. The Prophet ﷺ says, "Ad-din al-nasiha." That religion is about advice and admonishment and sincerity. Then they asked him, whom should we give it to? He says, to Allah, to His Messenger, and to people in authority from amongst you. The same word used in the Quran, people in authority from amongst you, meaning you choose them, not people in authority over you. There is no such a thing as over. Nobody is over the Muslim but Allah. A Muslim never bows down except to Allah. And he gives no commitment to anybody that runs contrary to his or her commitment to Allah, including wife to a husband, a child to parent, a worker to employer. No authority. No authority should ever circumvent the authority of Allah or run between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to understand and give our commitment and live in good manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt, wa'afina fi man afayt, وتولنا في من توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين اللهم لا تدع لنا في يومنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا همّا إلا فرجته ولا كربا إلا نفسته ولا ضالا إلا هديته ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته ولا مجاهدا إلا نصرته ولا ظالما ولا طاغية ولا جبارا إلا قسمته اللهم عليك بالجبارين وعليك بالمتكبرين وعليك بالطغاة المعتدين اللهم انصر الإسلام وأعز المسلمين وأعلي بفضلك يا رب كلمتي الحق والدين اللهم اجعلنا ممن ينصر دينك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم اجعلنا على الحق المبين واختم لنا بخاتمة السعادة أجمعين مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فستذكرون ما أقول لكم وأفوض أمري إلى الله إن الله بصير بالعباد وأقم الصلاة.